Hello and bienvenue, my people of extraordinary taste. Today we're going to get to the bottom of the mystery that makes us question why birds, reptiles, and these adorable nightmares on wings have adapted nearly identical body plans. I'm Ben, the quasi-ecologist, and welcome to the Natural World Explored. Now, did you know that birds, bats, and pterosaurs all grew their wings by extending out their finger bones and filling in the blanks? This is an interesting fact to consider because that means that all three of these families evolved the same form of wings from very different animals. You see, bats evolved from small shrew-like mammals, while birds evolved from dinosaurs not so different from the raptors that you know and love. And this family of reptiles, called pterosaurs, evolved from something called a lagerpetid. So not only did these animals come from very different backgrounds, but if we were to put them on a timeline, you'll see that they also evolved millions of years apart from one another. So what led these three families to develop very similar adaptations despite being very unrelated? To understand convergent evolution and what it actually is, we first have to understand evolution itself. Evolution is the gradual development of organisms as they acquire and spread new genetic traits. New traits may occur in an individual randomly, resulting in a mutation or a variation of the species' genetic code. This trait could be an advantage, it could be a disadvantage, or it could have absolutely no effect on the individual at all. If the trait is a disadvantage, then it's less likely that the animal will be able to breed and pass on the trait, whereas if it's an advantage, then congrats, they're more likely to have kids and therefore pass on the genes. Traits that make a species more likely to have children are considered advantageous, because the species is usually more likely to stick around if they can breed consistently. There are plenty of ways that organisms can improve their chances of successfully breeding. They could develop some sort of elaborate mating display. They could become physically better at defending their entire pack, or they could become more, let's go with fertile. Alternatively, in order to make themselves live longer, organisms could evolve a trait that makes an individual better at obtaining or consuming food. They could evolve a defensive trait to decrease their chances of being eaten, or new behaviours such as strong parental instincts in order to increase the survival of their children and peers, and by extension, themselves. So once again, returning to that same chart that we looked at earlier, once a trait has appeared that results in an individual having more offspring, the trait is then more likely to be passed on to the next generation because that individual is more likely to be contributing to the next generation anyway. There are, as you can imagine, a bunch of variables involved in this. There is the possibility that an advantageous trait just might not be passed down to their children. This is because random chance is a pretty core piece of genetics. So now that we understand that evolution is based on these random changes in genetic code, we can start to look at convergent evolution and get to the bottom of why species evolve to be very similar to one another. So according to a 2016 article by Washburn, Bird, Conant, and Pyers, there are three forces that act on species that encourage convergent evolution. The first of these is that... In other words, if something works well for an animal that lives in one environment and eats one thing, it'll probably work well for similar animals that live in similar environments and eat similar things. As an example, let's take a look at the giraffe and the extinct dinosaur Giraffa Titan. For now, we'll ignore the fact that the dinosaur's name just means Titanic giraffe, and we'll focus on the overall body plan of these animals. Both of these animals evolved to reach the tallest leaves on the tallest trees to outcompete other animals that can't reach that high. This is an example of two animals that live in similar environments and eat similar foods that evolve similar traits because having long necks just works well if you're trying to eat tall leaves. The second force is that, or again, in other words, some things are just straight up impossible to evolve. This could be anything from the physical limitations of living in Earth's gravity to limitations in the way different chemicals are able to work together. It unfortunately also rules out animals with wheels. As you can imagine, the list of impossible adaptations is a lot longer than the list of possible ones. In fact, it's infinite. So given that only a small number of adaptations are even possible in the first place, the chances of more than one animal picking up the same trait is a lot higher than you may expect. The third force that encourages convergent evolution This is the random chance that I was talking about earlier when we explored evolution. It is the random potential that genes in any given population will stick around, newly evolve, or spontaneously disappear. From this reasoning, we can establish that unrelated species that play similar roles in similar environments will likely evolve the same or similar viable traits if they're an advantage. So, let's take it back to our old friends, the bats, birds, and the pterosaurs. All three of these groups evolved initially to better catch flying insects, and the best way to do that is to beat them at their own game. Flying. If, like me, you've spent a day on Earth, then you'll be more than familiar with the fact that flying insects are fast and they can turn sharply. So to catch them, you'll need to be quite fast and precise. As it turns out, this body plan of large wings with a mobile head is pretty good at precisely catching flying prey, and it wasn't until later that these three families evolved to take advantage of flight to eat other foods, like fruit, rodents, and fish. Let's look at another example. Dolphins, sharks, and the extinct ichthyosaurs all look incredibly similar, probably even more so than the previous example, yet they have dramatically different backgrounds. Sharks are fish, dolphins are mammals, and ichthyosaurs are reptiles. So let's bring up that timeline again. Now, as you can see, these three animal families have absolutely nothing in common origin-wise and evolved millions of years apart. But because we're all geniuses here who understand convergent evolution now, let's think about their diet and their environment. All three of these families eat small fish and live in the ocean. To consistently catch small fish in the ocean, you'll need to be able to swim fast with precision, or have like a spear gun or something. As a result, all three of these families came to very similar solutions on how to best catch fish by developing the same overall body plan. There's a pretty staggering number of convergent evolutionary traits in the animal kingdom, and they aren't just restricted to body plans. Let's take a look at a few examples. Echolocation is the ability to make sounds that reflect back at an animal, which they can then use to locate prey or map out their surroundings. It's what we based sonar and radar off of. Toothed whales, microbats, and some shrews have all evolved this ability, and two different families of bats have evolved echolocation after they had split apart from one another already, meaning that bats may have evolved it twice. Convergent evolution isn't just restricted to the physical either, it can even come in the form of behavior adaptations. All of the ants that you see on screen right now have evolved a behavior known as slave making, where they steal larvae from the nests of other ant species and use them as the labor force for their nest. This is a particularly grim behavior that has evolved across multiple ant families and completely independent of each other. Well, would you look at that, it's time for today's game. Today's game is
a game of crabs.
And no, not the lice that live on your downstairs here. We're talking about crabs that live in the sand and such. Can you tell me which of these crabs is a true crab? Was your answer none of them? There are five groups of what we refer to as crabs, not including horseshoe crabs. And they all evolved independently into basically the same shape. This is called
quasi-ecologist.
That's right, people. There are even forms of convergent evolution so common that they get their own dang name. And it turns out that this body plan is so dang successful that nearly every coastal arthropod wants to join in on the fun. Now you can see these structures and consistencies not only throughout the animal kingdom, but throughout all life. Plants, fungi, and single-celled organisms have all evolved and re-evolved the same traits over and over again, following those forces that we discussed earlier. Life is bound to a set of rules, external influences, and of course, random chance. There are lessons to be learned in this fact. We have the unique ability to affect our environment and the external influences we open ourselves to. So together, let's learn about the world, identify these influences, and what we can do to promote the good over the bad. So until the next episode, I'm Ben the quasi-ecologist, this is Natural World Explored, and as always, stay curious, friends.